تعادل يا عم، تعادل ليه؟ اجي يا اخي، ني مس بدي تعادل يا ري.
Today is the third day of our summer teaching.
Heute ist der dritte Tag unserer Sommerunterweisung.
So I'd like to offer my welcome to all of the
und wünsche, dass es euch gut geht.
So to continue where we were from yesterday, we have spoken about Sojong, and we have talking about the rains retreat. And so today we've come to the spot where we're speaking about the Pravarana ritual.
Davor zu fahren.
And so this is a ritual that the Sangha members would have to perform before they went on to the on traveling after the rains retreat. Other Sangha together for 2 days. However, according to our Mula Savasavada tradition, he said that it had to happen over 2 days. And I don't know whether this is something that is in other Vinayas or just in the one.
Und während dieses Auflösens, dieser gemeinsamen
So now the reason is because during the rains retreat, the monastics were not allowed to speak about each other's offenses. Now, every 2 weeks, there is the Prasada ritual where you talk about your offenses and so forth. But during the rains retreat, you're not allowed to speak about any offenses that contradict theory. And so because this is prohibited during the rains retreat, once the rains retreat is completed, then the scriptures, the restriction of not speaking about the offenses is then released, and then you're allowed to speak about the offenses after that. But so if you're doing the Pravarana, then if you're doing it authentically, then you should confess everything that you have, all the offenses you have done without hiding any to the Sangha. And then the Sangha would listen to the offenses, and depending upon the severity of the offense, they would determine a punishment for the offense. So that basically covers the Pravarana section. Following that, another important ceremony of the Sangha is the Katina. The ceremony of spreading the Katina. So it is called spreading the Katina. Now, there's an Indian scholar named S.R. Goyal. And what he says is that after the completion of the Pravarana, you have to do the ceremony of spreading the Katina. So this is according to the Indian scholar. It happens after the releasing the scriptures. Now, the reason for this is that during the that the faithful students would offer the fabric, and then the new robes would have to be made, and then distributed and shared among the Sangha. So this is what he says. However, according to our Mula Sarvastivada tradition, what it says in the Vinaya is a little bit different. When you talk about spreading the Katina, this is the name. So this is this name. It's not an easy term to understand. So when you talk about spreading the katina, it means that the Sangha members would make the three new Dharma robes. They'd have a stable wooden board, and they'd lay their three Dharma robes on top of this. They'd stretch them out on top of this. So the Tibetan word means sakyang, or spreading on the ground. It means that you need the stable spreading. So the stable means it has to be a stable bowl, a stable board that you're able to spread the Dharma robes on, and then you need to spread them along it. So it means to spread or to lay out the Dharma robes on top of this board. Now this board has a size. It's the same as the size as a large sangata, basically the size of the sugata size sangati, or outer robe. And so on that size board, you would have to lay out your three Dharma robes. Now, while spreading out the Dharma robes on this board, then the entire Sangha, and primarily the bhikshus here, normally they bless their robes, right? And so they take all the robes and they would transfer the blessings of their robes, or bless the new robes. And after they have transferred the blessings to the new robes, then two sets of four bhikshus. So this means a total of eight bhikshus would remain there to guard the katina, and all the rest. Would go off traveling and wandering for about 5 months. So they would go traveling for 5 months. And because of this, the reason for spreading the katina is that ordinarily, Zashi is very difficult for an ordinary individual to bless their Dharma robes. And also just because often there is excess food. You usually only have food once a day. You're only allowed to eat in the morning. And with cloth, you often end up with extra cloth. And so there are therefore no be more of the four-foot downfalls. Now, if the blessing of the katina, so they would have to come back before the blessings of the katina. If they can come back before that period ends, then they would be able to share the offerings to the entire Sangha. And so that is one benefit of the katina. Now, if you have not sat the rains of retreat, then you don't have the right to participate in spreading the katina. And if you don't participate in spreading the katina, then you don't have an opportunity to receive a share of the offerings to the Sangha. And you don't always have the sort of relaxation, that 5 month period of relaxing the strictures about blessing the robes and so forth. And so the spreading the katina was more or less performed in this way. However, in Tibet, this tradition of spreading the katina, whether did it happen or did it not? So in Tibet, during the later spread of the teachings, there was a Damchimpa Yeshe Lama who was well-versed in the Lungwa scriptures, and he did a katina ritual. But at that time, there were some bad signs, and because of that reason, from that point, the practice of spreading the katina did not continue, and so this was the transmission was interrupted. This is how it's recorded in some histories. So when we look at this, it seems like the practice of spreading the katina just in general did not occur. However, At the very beginning of the later spread of teachings of Tibet, there was this spreading the Katina, but since then, there have not been any Katina ceremonies. So now I've completed the discussion of the Katina. So to continue now, we'll speak about the origin of monasteries. Now, when we talk about the origin of monasteries, then what the Indian scholar S.R. Goyal says, so he's the researcher I mentioned before, he says that as the Sangha's numbers increased and as the custom of the rains retreat developed, then there began to be monasteries or viharas. And so this is his position. Likewise, there are some Japanese scholars. And what some Japanese scholars say is that originally, the monastics never stayed anywhere for a long time. They didn't stay in any fixed location. They were always wandering and traveling, going to other places. They were wandering everywhere. So wandering here doesn't mean just going without any purpose, but it's going to any sort of location. And it's not that they stayed in one location, lived there, and settled there. But gradually, this changed. And so first there, tradition of leading a wandering lifestyle changed to a settled lifestyle. Now it took us a period of time for it to change from the wandering lifestyle to the settled lifestyle. It's not like the wandering lifestyle changed all at once to the settled lifestyle. But this change must have happened during the time of original Buddhism, when the Sangha was originally forming. It had occurred during the lifetime of the Buddha. Now, the fact that it settled shows that the Sangha had improved or developed and had become more powerful. Now, at the very beginning, there were not very many rules in the Vinaya, and the Vinaya regulations became more and more upon also according to different incidents. And so because it happened because of incidents, then it doesn't happen all at once. It's not like all the incidents happen on one day. So the Vinaya regulations were not formulated in a single day. In one day, there was an incident, then in another couple months later, there was an incident, and maybe there were 2 or 3 years before an incident. And so the rules were made in the order that these incidents happened. And so in this way, the Vinaya rules developed gradually. And eventually it became so that the Sangha no longer needed to travel from place to place, but could settle in a single place and become a monastic community there. Now, as I said yesterday, there are two different types of places where the Sangha would stay during the rains retreat. There were the avasa, which would be the residences, and the other was the kungarawa, or the arama, the groves. So whether it's a residence or the pleasant groves, these were actually just places where they stayed temporarily during the rains retreat. They were not permanent residents. The owner of the land would take care of the place between the rains retreats, and the Sangha would not remain there to take care of it. They would only stay there during the rains retreat. But we have these groves or these parks that were in the vicinity of cities or just outside of them. Now, another name for this is, can also be called a pleasant grove, or they can also be called flower gardens and so forth. So basically, they're like parks. So they're places that are kind of nice, and there are nice trees, and there are fruit trees and so forth. And so they're sort of these like parks or gardens. Now, the owners of these parks had faith in Buddhism, and they always re-invited the Sangha to come back, and they basically offered it to them. But then gradually the place became a gathering place for the Sangha, became a place for the religious gatherings. It became an important place to practice listening, contemplation, and meditating. And so when that happens, then the places are called Sangharama. And here I've got something to show you. So these are places that became subtle places to do listening, contemplation, and meditation. These places became called Sangharama, which means causes groves for the Sangha. So it used to be that they were like pleasant groves or flower groves. Then gradually they became called the Sangha groves for the Sangha, or the place for the Sanghas to stay. There are places for the Sangha to stay and engage in listening, contemplation, and meditation. And so for that reason, they became called the Sangha groves. And so this is what is called in Tibetan, Chelan. And so, and this is a Chinese word, and it's used in Chinese Buddhism, and it's also in Japanese Buddhism. And so the Japanese scholar says, Omada Gyoke, says that this is a term that has been used from ancient times to this day. And so the Chinese word Chelan, which is, refers to a monastery, is formed because of this word. Now, according to some Japanese scholars, when we talk about these pleasant groves that originally were just the places that the owner had offered to the Sangha, then not only did they offer it, then even when the Sangha was not resident, they continued to maintain the places. And so the responsibility for the place was taken by the sponsor. But later, this became like a settlement for the Sangha. So as more monks began to reside at the location, it became a place for the bhikkhus to engage in listening, contemplating, and meditation. It came for places to gather, and also it's places where they did the poshada, the paravarana, and the katina, and other such rituals. So there are all these ceremonies that that the Sangha had to gather, and the Sangha had to gather for began to improve, or they began to develop. It's like at the beginning, there's not much to do. There weren't any of these. And then gradually, the poshada, the rains between the paravarana and the katina gradually developed. And so these became places where so many members of the Sangha the Sangha had to go. And so there are more and more rituals where the Sangha had to gather. And because of that, and so because there became what we call Upatthanasala, or the ritual or the temples where many, you know, where many monks would have to gather. So the bhikkhus would have to always gather in there, and sometimes it would rain. And so if they didn't have a rain, then that's, and if it began to rain and you don't have a house, then it's difficult, right? So they began to build buildings as temples for the Sangha. And these are what we call the Upatthanasala. You know, if we translate this into Tibetan, this is what we'd call an assembly hall or a temple. And so this is how that began. And because of this, when you're building the temples, these began called Lena. Or if we translate it into Tibetan, they become monasteries. So that's if we talk about a monastery. If you're going to say call something a monastery, you have to have something to point your finger at, right? So if you just have a place, then there's nothing that you can call a monastery. But when you gather the sangha and then build a temple, then only then do you have can you say this is a place where the sangha stays? And so then it takes the form of a monastery. And so that is how the form of monastery is developed. So there's a monastery. I'm going to just say the monastery, just to make it easy to understand. I'll just use that word. The actual word is lena. And so this Pali word is the Pali word is lena. So when you talk about a lena or a monastery, there are five different types of them. There is one that's called a temple. Then one called an adho yoga. One is called a pasada, the fourth is a pamiya, and the fifth is called a guha. So these five different types of buildings. Now the temple is the one that we always use, and no need to explain it. An adho yoga is a difficult one to understand what it actually means. Some people say that it's a building with no different stories. There are different explanations of the terms, so I'm just going to say adho yoga for it. I'm not going to try to translate it into Tibetan. Then pasada means like a large house or a palace, like a big building, kind of like a royal palace. So it'd be like a very elaborate building. And then there's a hamiya. Hamiya is probably this. Here I've written that it's like a multi-storied building. So it's a building with multiple stories. So that's ordinarily what we speak about. And then there's guha, which means a cave. Like whether a mountain cave, you can say. Now when you say a cave, it doesn't mean that it's a naturally built. It can also be like a human-built cave. Or sometimes they're like caves that are assembly halls that are built in as caves. And so these five different types of buildings. So among these, then the viharas in the caves became permanent. So once a temple was built, and then it became a permanent structure. And if you made a cave, then it was then became permanent. Particularly if you carve a cave into a cliff, then it's a permanent, right? Now, when you talk about the reason why the temples originally began is that during the rains retreat, the individual bhikshus needed places to stay. They had to have residences, and for the sake of that, they built the viharas. Later, the vihara or the temple became like a place where people performed the rituals together. And so then it no longer referred to the individual residences, but to the temple where everyone gathered. And so then it became the Sangha Vihara. So the Sangha Vihara means the general Sangha thing. For example, when we talk about this, when you talk about the temple, we talk about the place where people where everyone gathers these days. It's used for the communal use of the sangha. Of course, in these days we sometimes have quarters from great lamas on the upper floors, but it's generally a place for the general sangha to gather. So, for example, you have there are also a few individual places for people to sit, similarly to the Tibetan ones, where we have the to the quarters for some monks and their roofs. So originally the Vihara referred to the incidental residences, and then there were then it began to refer to the general communal temple, and then there were residences for original residences for the other individual monks around it. And so it was both a place for communal usage and a place with residences for individual monks. Later, as the temples became fancier and fancier, then there became many different sizes of temples. The larger ones, and so a temple was not just a single building, but like a collection of buildings, and that's what was called an organized set of buildings, or building with a particular architecture was called the temple. Then we have the caves. The caves, as I said before, doesn't necessarily mean a naturally occurring cave. It can also mean a human-made cave. And the caves were places where, during the time of the Buddha, where bhikshus practiced dhyana meditation. When you're practicing dhyana meditation, it's best to have these in places where people can't see you, in isolated places, so they often stayed in caves. Now, in India, in the south, the natural division between North and South India is the Vindhya mountain range. So this is in the middle of India. It performs like a natural boundary between the northern and southern. On the northern regions, the cave dwellings were made of bricks and rock walls. But in the higher location in the south, most of them were caves that were carved into cliffs. So it's basically in the northern, you had more temples that spread. And they would build them out of brick and build them out of and rock, and they'd build the walls out of this to make a temple. Now, in the south place of in the south, there were more caves, and they'd go to a cliff, and they would carve out the caves. So whether you're in the temples in northern India, or whether you are talking about the caves in southern India, they all had all the facilities necessary for the entire Sangha. They had all of the individual residences and places for people to gather and so forth. So to show them to you. So these are the ruins of some Indian, some places in India. There's the Shalvan Vihara. And the Totlakonda, the ruins of the Totlakonda rituals. So these are the ancient residences. Now, it's difficult to say that these were from the time of the Buddha himself, but they probably were built in the first or second century of the Common Era. So they're built during the Common Era. But in any case, these are ruins of monasteries. And as I was mentioning, the caves, as I mentioned, these are in the South India. They're the famous caves in the South. There's the Ajanta and Ellora caves, which are very well known. So these are very famous caves. And as I said before, within this, they would carve out of this, out of the cave, and they had built like the form of the monastery as it. It's not like in Tibet where you have a natural cave where someone stays and you don't particularly do anything to it. But the southern India caves were carved out of the cliff face by people, and they built in various different forms. And these are what are called, these become very large temples. Now, I have not gone there myself, but I think you probably know about this. So in any case, the caves were of this form. So in brief, if I kind of summarize all of this, the Japanese of the Umada Gyoke, what he says is, So that originally the Sangha, when it first developed, the Sangha was around, stayed with the Buddha there, in the presence of the Buddha. And then gradually the bhikkhus, the Buddha, monastics normally went wandering, and they could stay anywhere. They just went wherever they happened to go. And they stayed wherever they were. And so they were traveling. It's like they stayed in a monastic or a nomadic lifestyle. And so for this reason, there's no real count of how many people are. They didn't have any fixed place they stayed, and it's difficult to count the number of people. Because if you have three people in this place, and then they go to another place, maybe there are a few people over there, and maybe some others have gone to another place. Like, for example, when you talk about a monastery, if you ask how many Sangha members are there, they can give you a pretty definite number. But in the old days, during the development of the original development of the Sangha, you couldn't say that. And the reason is because they would go someplace else. And when they go off, then half of them will go to one place, half would go to another place. And so you could never really say for certain how many bhikkhus were in a certain place. And even if you think about the way they lived their life and the way they did the practice, it depended upon their own individual situation. At the beginning, there was no Vinaya ritual. You just did whatever is practical at the moment. So they would look at their own situation and decide what they need to do, what is best to do, what is going to be most beneficial, and they'd examine themselves in that way. And there wasn't any particular Vinaya discipline. Later, as the rules of the Vinaya were formulated, then, and likewise also the Buddha's great disciples, Madhgalayana and Shariputra and Kashyapa, were told by the Buddha to gather groups of Sangha members themselves and to guide them in their practice. So this is the Buddha instructed them to do this, and as they had been instructed, they each ended up having quite a few different students. Shariputra and Madhyamani, each of them had several hundred students. And once they had several hundred students, so there are several hundred of Shariputra's disciples, there are several hundred disciples of Madhgalayana. They'd give their students each their own instructions, and they were allowed to nurture their own students. And the numbers of their disciples grew more and more. And as this kept happening, then the Madhgalayana and his students would go to one different place. And so Madhgalayana's students wouldn't all stay in with him. Some would go to the east, some would go to the south. So this is the situation. So at that time, we think of that time as the time of the Buddha, as all of the Sangha members staying at a single place, but it wasn't like that. They weren't all able to stay in a single place because there are so many of them. There are so many students, they're taken by their teachers to go to all various different places. And so they weren't really able to stay in a single place. So the order grew larger, there are more and more people. And so in order to maintain the organization, then you have to guide the Sangha, you had to have like rules to do so. If you don't have rules and regulations, then you can't gather Sanghas. And so they have to have times when the Sangha can gather and discuss things. And so because of this, then eventually the Vinaya rules became more and more important. So the Vinaya rules, as I said before, are like the organizations that governed how the Sangha happens. And also are these rituals where the Sangha had to repeatedly gather to perform the rituals. Now those days it was kind of like a democratic. So the Sangha community is very democratic, and they would all gather, and everyone had to express their own opinions. And we, so we talk about the rituals of action at that time, that is the Sangha's ways of doing business. So the way the Sangha does business is called the rituals of action, right? So these had to be done in assembly. So as the Sangha grew larger, then they were able to, then they no longer stay in a single place. Because of that situation, they developed all the rituals of actions and the rules of the Vinaya, which eventually became very important. Even when the Buddha passed into Nirvana, actually when the Buddha passed into Parinirvana, then you would think that all of the Buddha's students should gather then. But at that time, many of the Sangha members at other places were unable to come to the cremation of the Buddha. And so this is the this situation did occur. Likewise, as the Japanese scholar says, generally there are many Buddhist sanghas, but there were, it's difficult to say any fixed, any definite number of how many there were. If we look at it according to him, so within a year or two after the Buddha reached Enlightenment, apparently is that there are probably around 1,250 bhikshus around had gathered. After that, many people continued to enter the Sangha. But it's difficult to say any definite numbers. But if you estimate, he says that later, there are probably 1,500 to 2,000 Sangha members. So this is what this scholar thinks. Now, if we look at it, if we look at the way he gathers, makes the estimate, that around the time of the Buddha's Parinirvana, probably there are somewhere around 2,000 or more members of the Sangha. I think that this is possible, right? And so that's how that is. Now, after this, I would like to speak about the different types of members of the Sangha, the classification of the Sangha. So I've spoken in rough about the development of monasteries, and so then following that, like the different types of Sangha members. Now, in the four agamas, there's the sutra called the Sutra on the Results of the Spiritual Way. And what it says there is that during the time of the Buddha, there are the six teachers of the six non-Buddhist schools, right? And these were all what people normally called them were either the heads of the Sangha or Sanghin, or they're called heads of communities or the teachers of the communities. So these are the names that they're called, because they each had their own Sangha, and there were the heads or the leaders of those, or the leaders of those communities. And so when they're speaking to them, they're called the heads of the Sangha, or the heads of the communities, or the teachers of the community. So this is the way they're described. Likewise, all six of these six non-Buddhist teachers are all actually had great knowledge, and they had good conduct, and they were well known. In particular, they had all been a long time since they had all gone forth, and they had great experience in being monastics. And so in this way, they were all elders. It had been a long time since they had taken their vows, and they became senior elder monastics. Likewise, there are like the founders of specific separate schools. And so the leaders of these different religions, and so everyone respected them greatly. Now, the instruction that came under these instructions of the spiritual way, so as we're talking about these, the shamanas, so the monastics who followed them. So these are probably when we talk about, these as the monastics, they had a monastic lifestyle. And so the assembly of those monastics who lived under their instruction were called a sangha or a gana. And so as I described yesterday, they're called a Sangha or a Gana. So this is not only the Buddhists, this also includes the non-Buddhist Hindu schools. The six non-Buddhist teachers also had their own independent Sanghas or communities. Likewise, as I mentioned the other day, the word Sangha is commonly used in society in social and political contexts. So it's also used for political groups. It's used for groups of business people or merchants. So it was a very well-known term. It was not solely a religious term or not solely a Buddhist term. So in brief, when you talk about a Sangha at that time, if you talk about it in terms of the religious tradition, what do we mean? Is that at times, what we mean are the people who followed the six teachers, who then followed their teachers wandering from place to place. They're assemblies or groups of people who practiced Dharma. There are Sangha who practice, and that's what we understand this. So there are many of these different assemblies at that time, or groups at that time. And because there are so many of them, when Buddhism first began to spread, what they called the bhikshus who were students of the Buddha, they called them the monastics of the son of the Shakyas, or in Pali, the Sakyaputtiya Samana. This means the monastics of the son of the Shakyas. And the Buddhist teachings of the Buddha were called the Dharma of the son of the Shakyas, Sakyaputtiya Dhamma. So the reason for this is that the monastics of the sons of the Gangas, there are so many monastics at that time, and because each of the six non-Buddhist teachers had their own monastics, and so that doesn't show how that they're different. And so you call them the monastics of the son of Shakyas. That's why so at that time, it wasn't just the Buddhist. There are many sanghas of other different schools, and so for that reason, as the Buddhist developed, they became there were like a subset of this, and it wasn't just that there was only so it's not that the only Buddhists had a sangha community or a group like this. In any case, when Buddhist originally developed, there really wasn't much discussion of the term Buddhism. No one saying, I'm Buddhist, and you're a non-Buddhist. It's like, it wasn't that Buddhism was a separate religion or a separate school. That happened later. When Buddhism first appeared, people didn't say, I'm Buddhist, you're not. There's not so much distinction at that time. At the very beginning, originally, when the Sangha developed, when Buddhism originally developed, their aim was primarily to spread Dharma. It's not, they weren't distinguishing or having any bias between our school and other schools. And so that reason the Buddha was called the completely perfect Buddha. The reason why he's called the completely perfect Buddha is it because of his experience of achieving, reaching enlightenment is what he taught to the students. And this is what the Sangha primarily practiced. So at that time, the Buddha said, I'm Buddhist and you're non-Buddhist. I mean, it's not like he started a separate school or a separate religion. That wasn't his aim. His main aim was that he'd undergone a lot of difficulties and hardships, and in the end, he achieved Buddhahood. And so when you say he achieved Buddha, he gained realization. When he gained the realization, his experience, what was most important was that he shared the superior experience that he had with others. And so he would spread it to the teachers. And he would say to others, his most important thing is that you should teach the experience to others. It's not like at that point you should say, I'm Buddhist, and I have a part of a particular school. It's not like a question of making decisions or making something new. It's not like separating it out. That was not his primary aim. In the very end, when the Buddha passed into Nirvana, at the moment he was passing to Nirvana, what he said is, he said, you must be your own protector. He said, you should go for refuge to the Dharma. He said, in the future, when I'm no longer present, you must go for refuge to the Dharma. You should take the Pratimoksha as your discipline and go for refuge to the Dharma. That's what he said. He did not say that in the future, you must uphold our so-called Buddhism, and he, this person is the leader of the teachings, and he's and this person is going to continue upholding my teachings. He did not say that. So that's how it was. We will now have a 30-minute intermission. Now we will speak about what the Sangha consists of. When we talk about what the Sangha consists of, then what we mean is what are the different forms of the monastic Sangha that the Sangha is consists of? So what the Sangha community is made up is there are the monastic or the and the monastics here refers to bhikshus and bhikshunis. These are the monastics. And then like there are in addition to this, like the supporter, there are the ones who will in the future become bhikshus and bhikshunis, who will be added to the bhikshu and bhikshunis later, are the novice monks and novice nuns, as well as the nuns in training. And so these five are called the five groups of the Sangha community, or the five groups of monastics. When we talk about the nuns in training, so the shikshamena, this means someone who has taken the novice nuns, who then spends 2 years in probation, basically testing whether they're able to take the bhikshuni ordination. Then only then may they take the bhikshuni ordination. And so these are called shikshamana. Now these five groups of monastics I spoke about before, which comprise the Sangha. And so the monastic Sangha consists of these five groups of Buddhist givenness. So either that, if you're a bhikshu, you have to be either the bhikshu or the bhikshuni. Now the bhikshu, of course, primarily refers to the bhikshu and the bhikshuni. The novice monks and the novice nuns are not the full Sangha. They're not the primary aspects, So it's primarily the bhikshus who are the main members of the Sangha. So it's for the male Sangha, it's the bhikshus, and for the female Sangha, it is the bhikshunis. Now we call this by the five groups in the Tibetan language, but within the Pali, they call them the five inner or internal communities. But when you talk about the word Sangha, if we use it more loosely with a broader meaning, if we are very strict about it, then we refer only to the monastic Sangha. But if we use the term in a looser sense, then we can divide it into seven groups. Oh, there's a little mistake there. So it's best to say the seven communities in the Sangha. So if we have a more broader understanding of the word Sangha, then we say the seven communities of the Sangha. And so these include the five groups of monastics that I mentioned before, and we add two to them. And what we add are the upasakas and upasikas, the male and female holders of the five precepts. So this means the people who have taken the vow of going for refuge to the Buddhas. So it's a tradition of calling these people who the five upasakas. But it primarily means the lay people who have taken the five precepts, such as giving up killing and so forth. So these are primarily what we mean by the five and male and female holders of the five precepts. And then there's also the fasting vows, so the who hold the vows for one hold the vows for the eight vows of fasting for a single day. Now, with the householders, among the householders, there are also people who have taken the vows to have given up the wearing scent and garland and so forth, and to not sit on high seats and to give up eating food at inappropriate times. And so these people were called upavasta, or dwelling nears. They've given these up permanently. But if we digress from here a little bit, in the Tibetan tradition, when you say the Tibetan Buddhism, we are talking about the Mula Sarvastivada Vinaya tradition. Within the texts of the Mula Sarvastivada tradition that have been translated into Tibetan, there's what we call is a venerable lay practitioner, or a Gome Ginyin. So there's a particular word. It's a particular type of name. And so there's a text by the Indian master Abhayakara called The Ornament of the Sage's Thought. Now, in this it says that the venerable lay vows are taking only the sojung vows for the rest of one's life. And this is an oral instruction, he said. So it's like a particular pith instruction, he says, because the sojung vows are the eight vows of the fast, right? And you take the eight precepts of the fast, and if you take them for the rest of your life, for an entire life, someone who takes these vows for the time is called the name of a venerable lay practitioner. This is how Abhayakara explains it. Likewise, there is also Lama Dorje Denpa's commentary on the eight vows. And he writes that taking the eight vows of the fast for the rest of one's life is to take the vows of a venerable lay practitioner. There is also Chöde Damstra Sena, who explains it in the same way. Likewise, Atishar, by his name, is also called by the name Dipankara Shidhyana. What he says is that in the Sarvastivada school, there's no presentation about venerable lay practitioners, but there is in the Mahasanghaka school, because there is the Punyashri. And Punyashri probably means Lama Dorje Denpa, I believe. Now, when you say venerable, so it says Gomi. And if you translate it into English, then it means venerable or monastic. So basically, the vow that they're keeping is a lay vow. So it's a vow for householder. It's an upasaka. It's included in the householder vows. It's not a monastic vow. But because they are taking the vow for permanently, they also wear monastic style robes as a factor for keeping the vow more simple. They're only gome or venerable, but they're not actual ones. They're nominally venerable. They're human as they wear monastic clothes and they stay wearing that. And so for this reason, they are called the gome or venerable lay practitioners. Likewise, if we talk about in the, now to continue into the, from the Tibetan tradition, There was an Indian master named Chandragome, who, according to the Tibetan tradition, was the same time as Chandrakirti. And he was a Gomi lay practitioner, a venerable lay practitioner. So someone who is a lay practitioner, but who wears the monastic robes, but actually keeps the precepts, but in actuality is a householder. So if you look at his, he says that there is no such in the Sarvastivada tradition, but there is in the Mahasanghika school. And so this is probably what is meant from there. Now, to return to our actual topic. So I've spoken about the seven groups of the Sangha, the seven parts of the Sangha. So these are the monastics and the lay practitioners. Likewise, the Sangha can also be divided in terms of the gender you've got, because you have you can talk about the male Sangha, which is the Sangha, you've got the Bhikshu Sangha is called the male Sangha, and the Bhikshuni Sangha is called the female Sangha. And so you can also classify it in this way. Or it can also be classified in terms of whether you have attained liberation or not. So the individuals who have achieved liberation, they are called the respectable or the venerable Sangha, or the honorable Sangha, and the other are called the conventional Sangha, because they're called, there's like the name that they're called by. Now following that, there's another way to speak about the dividing the Sangha, which I will speak about. When I speak about all these different classifications, talking about bhikshus and bhikshunis and so forth, these are all based upon the stages of a person's practice and in terms of the question of which vows they're holding. So those who are holding the bhikshu or bhikshuni vows are bhikshus, those who are holding the novice vows are novices and so forth. And so the Sangha is divided according to the different vows that people hold. Likewise, if you describe a bit according to the gender, then you can talk about the male Sangha and the female Sangha. But there's another way of dividing the Sangha, which is what we could say the local Sangha, and then there is the Sangha of the four directions. So this is another way of doing it. Now, this is in the Tibetan, this is in the Tibetan canon, but it's not something that we normally speak about it. So I thought I would speak about it a little bit. Now, there is a Japanese scholar named Hirakawa Akira. Now, he's passed away already. He, in general, was a great scholar who researched Buddhism, and he did a great deal of research into Vinaya. He knew Sanskrit and Pali, and he was very skilled in both of these languages. He took some interest in Tibetan as well. In particular, he wrote a history of Indian Buddhism, and this is considered to be a very high level among the contemporary researchers of Buddhism. So Hirakawa Akira says that a local Sangha, now he's primarily, he speaks Chinese and he speaks Sanskrit, but he's primarily taking the Pali as his basis. What he says is that the local Sangha, what this means is, the people who are, it means like a Sangha that is presently, visibly present here. So that the people who are actually present, and so this is what we mean by the local or the visible Sangha. Better if I close that. So if you have more than four bhikshus gathering in a single place, then that is called a local or visible Sangha. As I said before, a Sangha means like a group. It doesn't mean an individual person. It means the name of a group, of an assembly. If you translate Sangha into Tibetan, you should translate it as meaning gathering or a group. So when you're talking about a group, You call several people gathering together as a group. You don't call just one individual person as a Sangha. So how many people need to gather before you can call it a Sangha? If you call it one, if it's just one, you can't call it a Sangha. Or two, you can't call it. If it's three, you can't call it. Four people have to gather for it to be a Sangha. So it has to be over four or more. So it's best if you have five, six or more, then you have a Sangha. But you have to at least have four. Only when you have four bhikshus together, then do you have a Sangha. So that's what that means. So the minimum number of members of a Sangha is that at least there have to be four people at a minimum. There have to be four bhikshus or four bhikshunis or more who gather. Now the boundaries of the place where the Sangha resides is called a sima, or a boundary. And so what this means, so we talk about boundaries a lot in the Vinaya. For example, these days, we talk about the difference between monasteries. You say, what monastery are you from? But in the original day, there weren't that many monasteries. In the original time, there weren't so many monasteries, not like today. There aren't so many, so much of the forms of a monastery. So you wouldn't say that you're from a member of the Sangha community. You wouldn't say what monastery you're from. So when you talk about a Sangha community, in Bodh Gaya, you'd say for around the origin there would be like five or six bhikshus around the area of the Mahabodhi temple, and five or six around the area of Tergar monastery. And so the ones around the bhikshus who are at the Mahabodhi temple would make like a boundary around their own area for there on the area there. The five or six bhikshus at Tergar monastery would make a boundary around their place. And so this is what we mean by boundary. Now, when you make the boundary within that, then if you come inside that boundary, if a bhikshu comes inside that, within that boundary, then they need to participate in the Sangha meetings of that gathering. For example, if there's a Sangha member, bhikshu who comes within the boundary of the Mahabodhi temple of the Sangha, then if they have a meeting or a ritual of action at the Mahabodhi temple Sangha, then he would have to participate in it. Now, the ways that bhikshus hold their meetings is called a ritual of action. So the gatherers would all get together, they'd perform some action, that is called a ritual of action. So for example, when you're having a meeting, then you have to someone who's chairing the meeting, who's administering the meeting. Because if you don't have someone chairing the meeting, it becomes like out of control and you don't have any to do that. So you have to have someone who's appointed to lead the you have to have someone who's appointed to lead the meeting. And so the name of the bhikshu who's appointed to lead the meeting is called the master of the action. This is primarily the person who's running the action or administering or organizing the action. So as a basic principle, all members of the Sangha must gather for the meetings. All the members of the Sangha within the boundary have to gather for this. When the bhikshus at the Mahabodhi's temple gather for a meeting, then all of the boundaries all the bhikshus within the boundaries for that temple have to gather there. In particular, this is definitely required for important gatherers such as poshada rituals and the appointment of stewards and other monastery workers and so forth. So for those important meetings, then all of the bhikshus who were present within the boundaries of that temple needed to gather. But when performing ordinary rituals of action, it's permissible for formal bhikshus to gather. Not everyone needs to gather. But for a certain particular rituals, there is a rules about the minimum number of bhikshus. For example, for the Pravadana ceremony at the end of the rains retreat, if there are not more than five or more bhikshus within the boundary, they may not convene. Likewise, for full ordination, there must be 10 bhikshus. We talk about the 10 bhikshus, then what you have this contains after the Kempo, the master of the action, the private questioner. So that's three. And then in addition, you have to have the seven witnesses. So in brief, you have to have the 10 bhikshus. Now later, in the in remote areas where there are not so many bhikshus, and it's difficult to gather 10 bhikshus, then at that point it was enough to have five bhikshus. And these have to include the bhikshu, the master of the action, the private questioner, and then two witnesses. And so if you have these five bhikshus gathering, you may perform the full ordination. Now, if a bhikshu has committed a downfall with the remainder, then you have to have 20 bhikshus to gather. You'd have to do 20 bhikshus or have to gather for the ritual of confession and purification. But for all the other rituals of actions, if every time there is a meeting or every time there's a ritual action, if everyone had to gather for all of these occasions, it would be very difficult and it would create obstacles for their practice. So when there were the ordinations or the confessions of downfalls of the remainders, then it was okay for 10 or 20 bhikshus to gather, and not everyone needed to gather. And so at those times, what they would do is when they're performing an action and they're having the meeting, when they're having the meeting or performing the action or the ritual during the ceremony, they would make a small boundary. They'd make another boundary. And at that point, all of the participants, the workers of this, would gather within a small boundary. And within that area, they would have all the bhikshus within that boundary had to participate in the action. All the other members of the Sangha did not have to gather within that Sangha. They all could do their own jobs as they needed. So basically, we're talking about this local or visible Sangha, which I mentioned before, right? This local Sangha, the visible Sangha, means the Sangha that is gathered. It's like an autonomous unit. It's like a Sangha. It's a unit of the Sangha, and it's an autonomous unit. For example, the community Sangha, the Sangha community at the Mahabodhi Temple and the Mare Sangha community at Teruga Monastery are autonomous. The one at the Mahabodhi Temple had all the rights and privileges to do what they needed to do in their own boundary, and the one at Teruga, the Sangha community would also could do what it needed to do, perform the actions that it needed, it had all the rights and the autonomy to do so. Likewise, they would perform the regular rituals according to the Sangha. If they have a particular, if they had a particular instance, they had the ability to make rules of conduct, internal rules of conduct that accorded with the Vinaya. They could make their own rules if any situation occurred. For example, with the Poshada and the Rains Retreat and so forth, it's not like you didn't have to, like the members of the Sangha at the Mahabodhi Temple would have to go to the Sangha at the Teruga Monastery and say, oh, please give us permission to conduct the Poshada or the Rains Retreat. You didn't have to do that. They did this autonomously. Likewise, there's also the communal property of the Sangha, such as the residences and the temples of the Sangha, as well as all the offerings of the Sangha. These were all split equitably and communally among the bhikshus. And all the food and clothing that were offered to the Sangha were shared equitably among the members of the Sangha. And this is how they lived their, supported themselves. And so this local Sangha is like all of the bhikshus in a location, the ones who are visible at that place. Normally we say this monastery and that monastery. Instead of saying that, in the old days, it'd say this Sangha community and that Sangha community. Now the second type of Sangha Okay, I've already gone over that. I forgot to show this to you. So this is that. Now, so the visible Sangha or the local Sangha, they had the Vinaya rituals. It was the Vinaya discipline that was taught by the Buddha, that there's the Vinaya rules taught in the Pratimoksha Sutra and so forth, and the local Sanghas were not allowed to change this at all. For example, the bhikshus at the Theragarh Monastery, the Sangha members couldn't gather there and say this Vinaya rule isn't going to make, so we're going to change it. They weren't allowed to do that. Likewise, like if the bhikshus or the Sangha members in Mahabodhi Temple were to gather together and say, oh, this, we're unable to practice this precept, we need to change it. They were not allowed to do that. Nor could they both gather together and make a decision to say, oh, we're going to change to the Vinaya. They were not allowed to do that either. And so the Vinaya discipline was superior to or greater than the local Sanghas. And it's more important than the local Sanghas. Likewise, the local Sanghas were permitted to use the communal property of the Sangha, such as temples and so forth, but they were not allowed to sell them. They couldn't sell them. They couldn't do business and sell them. They couldn't sell the communal property. And so for these two reasons, this local Sangha does not have all the authority or all the abilities. There has to be, so when you think about it, then is there a Sangha that's superior to the local Sangha or not? Is there a Sangha that is able to change the monastic discipline or is there not? So even if the local Sangha is not allowed to sell the communal property, is there a Sangha that is allowed to do that? The answer to this is the Sangha of the Four Directions. The Sangha of the Four Directions is the second type of Sangha. The Sangha of the Four Directions should be understood as like, it's not an actual gathering of a Sangha. It means the Sangha itself. It's not a particular Sangha. It's not a particular Sangha. It's like the abstract Sangha. It's the local Sangha is a particular Sangha. The Sangha of the Four Directions is like the overall, it's like the overall, the abstract idea of the Sangha. So this Sangha is the overall Sangha. So the general Sangha is the Sangha of the Four Directions. And the Four Directions is not distinguished between time or place. Because it's the general, the universal Sangha, so no matter what place you're at, no matter what time you're at, whether it's the past or it's the future or the present, it refers to all of the Sanghas in the three times. And there's no limit to it in terms of location either. For example, it's not just India and Nepal, for example. It's not just this world. There may be bhikshus in other worlds too, right? So they're also included in this. So that's not limited in terms of place, nor is it just limited in terms of time. The ones in the future and the later. So all the bhikshus, all the members of the Sangha, the past, present, and future are all included. So when we think about this, how we can understand this is the Sangha of the Four Directions is a Sangha, or it's like the universal Sangha, shows that it's superior to the Vinaya rules. Because if you think about it, the Vinaya rules were made for the sake of the Sangha. The Sangha was not made for the sake of the rules. Is in order to administer the Sangha community, to create a regulated organization. And for this Sangha to do well, the regulations were made. So it was made for the sake of people. It's not like the people were made for the sake of the regulations. So if we think about the universal Sangha, so the universal Sangha is superior to the Vinaya rules. So for this reason, the Sangha of the four directions probably can change the Vinaya rules, but that's very difficult. When you talk about the Sangha of the four directions, as I said before, you said the Sangha of the four directions, it's the universal Sangha, not an ordinance. It's like all Sanghas. And so for that reason, if you need to change that, the Vinaya rules, then all the Sanghas you have to go to. And if you can't gather all the Sanghas, then it doesn't work. Not just this world, but in other universes, all the Sanghas in all universes that there are, then that's no way that could happen. And so that's what we mean. So that's how we can understand it. So next, I thought I would speak a little bit about the Bhikshuni Sangha. Now with the Bhikshuni Sangha, I've spoken a lot about the Sangha. And we have the Bhikshu Sangha, the Bhikshuni Sangha. Now the female Sangha, the Bhikshuni Sangha, At first, the Buddha did not really have much of a wish to allow women to go forth and enter the Sangha. He didn't want to do that. But there was his aunt, Prajapati, who had raised him since he was very young. He was a second wife of King Suddhodana. So King Suddhodana had primarily two main wives, and the first was the Buddha's mother, Mahadevi, and the second was Prajapati. So the Buddha's mother passed away about a week after the Buddha passed away. She died very quickly. And after she had passed away, the one who took care of him, the one who raised him, was Prajapati. So Prajapati requested him many times, repeatedly, please allow us to go forth and become an ascetic. She asked for permission many times. In addition, Ananda supported her. And only then did the Buddha consent to women going forth. Now, there's a lot of history background to this, but I don't need to say it all. Now, at the same time, now, in order for women to enter the Sangha, he made eight rules or eight facilities for the temple. These are called eight rules, and the rules are called the eight heavy dharmas. This is called Ashtagaru Dharma. The Ashtagaru Dharma. Now, what these eight rules are, I should show them, but I wasn't able to make them. I was going to just show them to you, but I was unable to make them today. But the first rule is that if she's even been bhikshu for 100 years, then if there's she still needs to pay homage to new bhikshu, someone who has just taken the ordination. So no matter what the seniority of a bhikshu has, there's no difference to the bhikshunis. They need to pay homage to all of them, regardless of their seniority. Likewise, the bhikshunis may not conduct the rains retreat in a place where there are no bhikshus nearby. The third is that every 15 days you have to do the poshoda, right? The sojong or poshoda ceremony. And during the poshoda, the bhikshunis do the bhikshuni on their own. And so the bhikshunis have to invite a bhikshu from the bhikshu sangha to read the Pratimoksha Sutra and to give them instructions. This had to happen all the time. So that's the third point. Now the fourth point, the first rule is that when the bhikshunis are performing the pravarana ceremony at the end of the rains retreat, it needs performed in front of a dual sangha. The bhikshunis could not do it on their own. Now, the fifth is that the bhikshus are unable to mock the bhikshus. That means that they're not allowed to criticize them or to mock them or to denigrate them. Now, the sixth is that when the bhikshunis are being ordained at the time they're taking their vows, or like with the bhikshus, the male bhikshus, they take it from the male bhikshu sangha. But for the bhikshunis, when they take vows, you have to have two sanghas gathering. You have to have the dual sangha. in particular. You have to ask for permission from the Bhikshu Sangha. And then the primary Sangha is the male Sangha. Both Sanghas have to gather, but the primary one is the Bhikshu Sangha. You have to ask them permission from the male Sangha in order to receive the Bhikshu Vas. That is how you have to take full ordination. Now the seventh is that the Bhikshus are unable to admonish Bhikshus for downfalls or remind people. They were not allowed to say that Bhikshus had such and such downfalls. And if a Bhikshu commits a downfall with a remainder, she needs to undergo the penance and do the confession and so forth in the presence of both Sanghas. So to have both Sanghas have to have it. So in brief, these are the eight heavy dharmas. Some people call them the eight heavy dharmas, and some people call them the eight dharmas of respect in any case. In any case, there are these eight precepts. Now, generally, in the Vibhajyavada and the Sarpavastivada traditions, it is said that the eight heavy dharmas were made by the Buddha. Not only did he make them, but they're also like the fundamental rules of the Bhikshunis. But if in the Mahasanghika Vinaya tradition, it is said that the Bhikshunis must keep the eight heavy dharmas, but it does not say that they are root precepts. So there's this difference. Later in modern times, there's a great Chinese master called Yin Shun. Many Chinese Buddhist schools study the text that Yin Shun wrote. So the textbooks that he wrote are used as a primary curriculum in the Buddhist schools of Chinese Mahayana Buddhism. And what he says is that the eight heavy dharmas, he has a doubt about whether the eight heavy dharmas were made by the Buddha. Now the reason for this is that so generally, when the Buddha made rules, he based them on some sort of incident. There was some sort of incident. There was an event, an incident that happened. And because of the incident, then the Buddha would create a new rule or a new regulation. That is how almost all of the Buddhist, the Vinaya rules are made. But the eight heavy dharmas, there's no particular incident or story about these eight heavy dharmas, and so there's a different way than how the Buddha normally made rules. However, but the rules within the eight heavy dharmas probably did occur during the time of the Buddha. And the reason for this is that it's because of women going forth during the time of the Buddhism. Then there was, that led to like a little bit of a dispute between Mahakashyapa and Ananda. So there's some sort of a thing between them, some sort of an incident between the two. So when you look at these, then possibly then the eight heavy dharmas were made when some traditionalist, rigid viewed bhikshus would express their opinion, and then these dharmas were made, the rules were made. So this is the doubt that Yin Shun has. So I thought I'd like to tell some stories about that, because if I don't ever tell any stories, because otherwise it gets a little bit boring sometimes. But these, I have to tell stories that are related to that. So this is related to that. So one story is like that. There are a couple stories here. So once the Buddha was staying at the monastery, the Buddha was staying in Shravasti at the monastery that had been donated by Anathapindada. And then there was also Mahakashyapa, who was a great disciple. He was one of the great disciples of the Buddha, right? And he was also staying in an older monastery at Shravasti called the Dhirkal Monastery. He was staying there, and in the morning, he put on his robes, he took his alms bowl, And he went off to beg for alms in Shravasti, to get beg for his food. And he was going on his way. There was a bhikshuni named Stulananda. So this bhikshuni's name was Stulananda. She misbehaved. She was probably the worst behaved of all the bhikshunis. So Stulananda, she also got up in the morning, put on her robes, she took her alms bowl, and went into Shravasta to beg for alms. And they got there at the same time. So Mahakashyapa going for alms and Stulananda going for bhajas, they got into Shravasti at the same time. And when Stulananda saw Mahakashyapa, she didn't like him at all. She doesn't, and I don't really know the reason why, but she didn't like him. So the moment she saw Mahakashyapa, this is a fool. And that fool has come, that idiot's there. I'm going to do something he doesn't like. I'm going to do something to upset him. I'm going to do something to give him a hard time. And when she thought this, then she was also, she thought of anything. She immediately could sort of see the house where Mishikampa was going. So she immediately went, she went really fast there. And she got there before Mahakashyapa could. She went there. And then she sat inside the door. Probably the householders didn't know that. She stayed inside the, hiding herself inside there. And she's hiding herself inside their doorway when gets to the door and then knocks him. Like he has to ring the bells on his staff. He'd ring the staff. You'd have to call somebody. You have to knock on the door and ring the bells on your staff and so forth. Isn't just saying, please, you have to give some sort of a sign saying, please give alms. And at that point, Stulananda is sort of hiding inside. So what she says is, she pretended to be a member of the house, and she said, oh, noble one. In the old days, you'd say this, noble one, there's no food now, go away. We don't have food, go away. Mahakashyapa hears that, and he immediately thought, oh, that's probably how it is. And he went off to another household. Went to their household. Then Stulananda got to that place. She got there. She went really fast and rushed there and got there before. And she went inside and hid herself inside. And then once again, Mahakashyapa got there. Then once again, she did the same thing. They said, and she said, oh, we don't have any food right today, so you should go. And so she did just like this. And Mahakashyapa, Mahakashyapa must not have got any food. He goes from one place, and this one over and over. I stand this over to, so in the end, Mahakashyapa didn't, at first he didn't think anything, but then when he got his, not just one, not just two, not three, there were many different houses. Whenever he went to anyone's house, there was no food there, and he started begin to doubt something. So when he got, Mahakashyapa was an arhat, right? So he had clairvoyance, right? It's not like he had it all the night. You have to do some meditation, samadhi, to get some meditation. So he did some samadhi. Then only then do you have some clairvoyance. And so when he looked and he entered his samadhi and he was looking, he said, oh, Stulananda's doing this. He understood that. He knew that. And when he knew that, then he said, then Mahakashyapa said to Stulananda, he said, oh, simmer. At this time, they would say sister. Pictures would call the bhikshuni sister. Oh, sister, it's your fault. I can't blame you. It's understandable. The person who made all these problems is Ananda. And the reason is, it's because Ananda is the one who had the Buddha ordain all these women who behave badly in the Dharma of Vinaya and make them fully ordained. So it's his fault. So all the offenses are his, not yours. It's not your fault. If Ananda hadn't had you be fully ordained, then you wouldn't have done anything. You couldn't do anything to harm me. So that's what he said. And so because of this rule, then when the Buddha heard about this, then after that, what the rule that he made is that is that the bhikkhunis may not beg for alms at home where Buddha, where bhikkhus were going for alms. So this is one new rule. So it's like, yeah, it's the way that Mahakashapa was talking about. It's not your fault. It's Ananda's fault. Ananda did all this stuff and allowed women to go forth. And so, the situation between the two of us is because of him. It's not all that. There was another time. So Stulananda, this picture named Gunandara, she also had some students. She had some, and she was sitting there teaching her students Dharma. And then Mahakashapa again came. He was coming along the road. And as he was walking by, the moment that she saw them, then all of her students, everyone gets up. All the other bhikkhunis got up because Mahakashapa was coming. But Stulananda didn't even lift her behind even a single bit. And she just sat there. And she was sitting there. And all her followers said to her, Mahakashapa was like, he's like worthy of veneration by all the gods and humans. He's such a great, great being. When you see someone like that, we got up and you didn't budge from your seat. That's not at all good, they said. Stulananda, the bhikkhuni, said to him, Mahakashapa is like, he's not really a good Buddhist. He was a Hindu. First he was a Hindu, and then he went forth. So he was just a complete idiot. And I'm somewhat, I went forth from the Shakya clan. I've memorized the three baskets of teaching. She must have known text very well. So when I see him, why is it that I should get up? And so because of this, the Buddha also heard about this incident. The rule that he made was, when a bhikshu sees a bhikshu, they must get up. It's not okay not to stand up. So he made another rule then. There's another story to tell. There's a lot of stories about this. This is the last story. So one time, Mahakashapa was in Shravasti and put on his robe and went for alms. At that time, it must have been summer. So you got, and all the rivers were full. And he was unable to cross a river. So he was crossing a bridge. And as he was crossing this bridge, then Stulananda saw him. And Stulananda says, "I'm not complete. There's that idiot. I'm going to do something to make him unhappy." And she thought this. She ran really quick and she got there. And she got to the bridge. She got to the bridge first and then she made it rock back and forth. And she was spreading. Now, this is like a bridge that was like, held up by ropes and stuff. So it's not like a stable bridge you do. And so she made it go back and forth, and Mahakashapa fell on the road, and all his robes got wet. His alms bowl sank in the river, and his staff was carried away by the river, and Mahakashapa was given a hard time. He was a noble being, so he didn't get angry at it because he was a noble being. And he said to Stulananda again, "Oh, sister, none of this is your fault. All of these, the person who's made all these problems is Ananda. Ananda allowed women to go forth and they become foolish, and he made them get fuller and made them to bhikkhus. And because of that, and this is why this incident happened. If Ananda hadn't got it so that women could go forth, then this incident would never have happened," he said. And when the Buddha heard about this incident, he made a new rule again. And the rule was that bhikkhunis are not allowed to cross a bridge at the same time as the bhikkhus. They're not allowed to be on the bridge at the same time. And so this, like it was, there are even worse stories than that. That's just making them fall in the water is pretty bad. There are even worse ones. If we talk about it. The woman had fallen in a cesspool that was filled with human excrement. She got Mahakashmu to fall into a cesspool filled with excrement. So there's that sort of story. So the Bhikshuni is Stulananda. I don't understand why she didn't like him, but at that time, the Bhikshunis at that time, they must have looked back, they looked down on Mahakashyapa. Mahakashyapa had like no problem. It's like, and he's the one who said that is the person who caused all of this is Ananda. Later, after the Buddha passed away, before the first council, Mahakashyapa actually kind of kicked out of the assembly because he had made many problems. He made several of them, and one of them was that he allowed women to go forth. This is one of them. And because of allowing women to go forth, and this decreased the length of the duration of the Buddha's teachings by 500 years. And so he said all these difficulties with Ananda. And so this is why, as the Chinese masters say, so as the Chinese master Jin Shun said, there are these different debates between or the situations because of between Mahakashyapa and Ananda, there's the situation between them. So we think that maybe the eight heavy dharmas were made because of at the request of the rigid traditionalist pictures. Okay. So I'd like to speak about the development of the Vinaya rules. So I've spoken about the development of the Sangha. So now you're speaking about the development of the Vinaya rules. Some Japanese guys say that they talk about a sutra called the Sutra of Brahma's Net. Now this is probably a section of the four agamas. Now this is not in Tibetan. The four agamas, the four scriptures, are probably scriptures from original Buddhism. They're very important scriptures of that time. It is in Chinese. There's a Srivastavada version of the four agamas in the Chinese tradition, and it's also in Pali, but it's not in Tibetan. But there are several sections of it that have been translated into Tibetan, but the entire four agamas has not been translated into Tibetan. So some Japanese scholars say that there is the Sutra of Brahma's Net, which is a part of the four agamas. Divides discipline into three types, greater, middling, and lesser. There's also a sutra called the Sutra of the Results of Monasticism, which is another section of the four agamas. And similarly to the Sutra of Brahma's Net, also divides discipline into three, so it's similar in content. But if you combine it all together, then it calls it the aggregate of noble discipline. So this is the name that it is given in that sutra. When we talk about discipline in Sanskrit, this is called shila. The meaning of the word shila can mean your nature, or your character, or your habituation, your practice, and so forth. This is what it should be understood to mean. So this contains the meaning of developing good habits and developing practice, changing bad habits into good habits, changing from the practice of non-virtue to the practice of virtue. So this is what discipline means. So perfecting discipline means that you're giving up all the behaviors that violate the discipline. You give up everything that is contrary to discipline, and you're able to abandon them. If you're able to do that, that is perfect discipline. So for that reason, when we understand discipline, it's like someone's commanding you, say, thou shalt not do that. You're not allowed to do this. That's not how we understand discipline. Discipline should be understood instead to mean like, so a discipline or shila means that you yourself, you're bringing out your own health. It's like, I'm going to do this. I'm going to see if I can do this. It's like that having, It's like a hope or an expectation that you are developing within yourself. And so it's like that hope or expectation or that ability that you're developing in yourself. Now, I spoke about how the three different types of discipline, the greater, middle, and lesser discipline. So among them, the lesser discipline is presented as being as giving up taking lies, giving up taking that which is not giving, giving up unchaste conduct, and giving up lying. The reason why this is called the lesser discipline is that it is discipline which also accords with non-Buddhist discipline, so it is considered the lesser discipline. Now, these four disciplines included with the lesser discipline and the four defeats taught in the Vinaya are exactly the same. And what this shows is that the Vinaya, the Vinaya was created in harmony with the practices and discipline of the wandering monastics of the time of the Buddha. It was not just something that the Buddha made up, because it's also for the non-Buddhists. So the four defeats of taking life and so forth were a general Indian religion and general Indian practices of people who were practicing meditation and so forth. So basically, when we talk about the word sila or discipline, is it something that you have to develop your own with, your own, rouse your own enthusiasm for it and so forth? It's not something that someone else is commanding to do. If you could change it, you can't really change yourself. If you really want to change yourself, you have to gather up your mental strength and enthusiasm yourself and practice it. Likewise, you have to have really made a clear decision to practice the Dharma. If you're unable to really have a clear, decisive mood of wanting to do this, then you're able to keep your discipline, keep the discipline. So you have to have that clear decision in order to practice the Dharma. Otherwise, you can't do it. Now, there's the discipline that is practiced living as a householder, and that is practiced after going forth. And the vows that you keep are different. So discipline is basically what they're talking about, administering the Sangha community, or they're talking about the livelihood of the Sanghahood. If you consider the way the Sangha community is run, these are all considered part of discipline. So that's basically how it is. That was not quite right. So discipline is, as I said before. Then in addition to that, the Vinaya is how the monastics administer the Sangha. It's how they run the Sangha. It's how they continue the lifestyle, how they can maintain the Sangha and maintain the rules of the community. And so these are many different conducts and codes of conduct and regulations. So that is what we mean by Vinaya. So the Vinaya is primarily for the monastics to keep. These are the rules and the procedures of the monastic company. This is what we mean by the Vinaya. Now, among the 250 or more rules, we always said there are 252 in the Mula Sarvastivada tradition, right? Within the other Vinayas, there are different numbers. So in around those 250 or more rules, then the most important of these are the four defeats. And if you break them, then you are expelled from the Sangha. And then the next one are the 13 remainders. And so that's that. Okay. So actually today I was going to speak a bit about the precepts in the Pratimoksha, but there hasn't been enough time. And I'm also a little bit tired, so maybe better not to speak about them today. Now I do have an announcement I would like to make. Now the announcement is that this is on the 12th, upcoming up on August 12th. Sometimes I can never remember what day or what month it is. I'm always forgetting that. So I can never keep the English names of months in head. In any case, this is the eighth month, the August. So on the 12th of August, as we have in the schedule, we will have it's the anniversary of Gampopa's Parity Nirvana. And so on that day, there won't be a teaching. And instead, we'll have the Gampopa Guru Sadhana. Now, there are several different Guru Sadhanas by Lodur Thay. There is the Swift Path, Guru Lajib, and so forth. And today, the one that we'll use, the most appropriate one, is the... There is a text by the first Dobson Tempurabje that was written. He had like a pure vision. It said that he was a emanation of Gampopa. So he had like a vision of Gampopa, and then he wrote a Guru Sadhana based on that. And then Jamgon Kontra Lodur Thay, Jamgon Kontra Rinpoche, compiled it and wrote this Gampopa Lodur. And then for the Gana Chakra, we'll use the one written by the fifth Karma Chakme Rinpoche. So we can combine these two, and I think that that's about the right length. Otherwise, if we do the Swift Path Gampopa Guru Yoga, by Rinzen Johnson Ningpo. So the Swift Path, Guru Sadhana was hidden as a treasure by Gampopa and is discovered by Jatsun Ningpo, the Tertian who found the Kunchuk Chido practice. Now, there are many different editions of this, but the one that's most well known by us is the one that is in the 15th Karmapa Khachap Dorjes. Now, this is very long, so I don't think we can do this one. Likewise, what also the other thing that is happening at the same time is a Karmapa Rangchen Dorje was passed away on the 14th day of the 6th Tibetan month. And then on the full moon day of that same month, his face appeared in a full moon. His face was seen in this, and so this is like the Karmapa's face in the moon, as we speak about. So then on that same day, and so what I thought is that if the weather is good, the monastery should all, if they have a lamp offering place, it should offer 100 lamps and so forth. If the weather is good, I mean. If you have a lamp offering room, then you can offer them there, it doesn't matter. But if you're going to offer them outside, you have to have good weather. And when the moon is rising on the full moon, then you should play music on the roof of the monastery. And there's a particular roof music that you play called the Dawa Yabse, and you can play that one. And basically, whichever music it is that you play is fine. And at the same time, you should also recite the three short texts by Rangchen Dorje. These are primarily related to the Shentong views. I think it would be best to recite those three. So on that day, so that is on the August 12th. There won't be a teaching, but I would like to say a little bit about the life of Gampopa and the third Karmapa Rangchen Dorje. And in particular, let's speak about the deeds and the activity of the third Karmapa Rangchen Dorje, and about how his face was seen in the moon, in the full moon on that day. So I'd like to ask you all to please take note of this. Now we will recite the closing prayers. Oh.